So let's get started. Today I'm, still in Matthew. I do plan after this sermon, really. So whenever I teach next, I'll be taking a bit of a break from Matthew, since we've reached the end of a portion, and therefore we've got a nice clean break where I can teach about some other things for a little while. But for today, I'm going to keep on here in section 6 of Matthew. And of course, this is the section that I've titled Jesus Pronounces Judgment Against Israel and Its Leaders. And that is because here in this section of Matthew, that is the theme that comes to the forefront as Jesus actually brings his ministry to an end there in the city of Jerusalem. For the past 12 messages in Matthew, I've been teaching through a united portion of section 6. Again, my outline is breaks Matthew into sections and then breaks those sections into portions. And I've been in a portion that I have always considered to be one portion, characterized by a confrontation between Jesus and the Jerusalem authorities, in which Jesus tells three parables. Although it takes him a while to get to those parables, that is where all of this is going. And I've titled this portion, The Leaders of the Kingdom Lose the Kingdom, because that, I think, is the idea Jesus is mostly trying to convey to them as he speaks to those authorities there in Jerusalem. And now that we've come to the end of that portion, we have a chance to review that portion together, and that is what I usually like to do, and that's what I'll do today. And this review will allow me to show you why I titled this portion what I did, The Leaders of the Kingdom Lose the Kingdom. I hope that you've seen that already as I've been preaching, but just in case, this will give me one last chance to bring all of these points together and show you what I think Matthew has wanted us to see in this portion of Christ's ministry. My outline today is framed around the six passages which together form this portion, so I will summarize those for you briefly here at the beginning so you can have them all in your mind at once. The first passage is the withering of the fig tree at the word of Jesus. The second passage is the question of the disciples about the fig tree and how Jesus answers them. The third passage is the argument between Jesus and the Jerusalem authorities over his authority and their authority. And then the fourth passage is the parable of Jesus about the two children. The fifth passage is the parable of Jesus about the vine growers. And then finally, the sixth passage is the parable of Jesus about the wedding feast. Those are the six passages that I consider to be the six passages of this portion that I have called The Leaders of the Kingdom Lose the Kingdom. Now, these six passages possess several features which I think do unite them together as a distinct portion. Whenever you look at the details of these passages, you start to see common bonds. The portion begins with Jesus finding no fruit on that fig tree, very notably, as he draws attention to that fact. And in much the same way, the later parable of the vineyard that he tells is all about that vineyard providing no fruit for its owner because of the abuses of the vine growers there. So there's a commonality. Furthermore, John the Baptist is mentioned twice. Although he's not been mentioned for a while in Matthew, he shows up twice in this portion. John is mentioned in the argument with the authorities over the authority of Christ. And then also in the first parable, he's mentioned as the person that caused the repentance of those tax collectors and prostitutes, unlike the leaders who did not repent. So there you have another link there with John the Baptist. You get to the last part of this portion and you have three parables. So the last half is all, in a sense, united by the fact that we have three parables, one after another. And then even within those parables, there are some shared themes. You may have noticed that all three parables feature a father and at least one child of that father. You have the first parable with the father and his two children, one obedient, one disobedient. You have the parable of the vineyard with a father who sends his son to that vineyard and who gets murdered there. And then finally, the last parable is the king who is throwing a wedding feast for his son. So all three parables feature fathers and children. Also, the first two parables feature vineyards, in that the father tells his children to go work in the vineyard, and one does and one does not. And of course, the second parable is the parable of the vineyard, where you see those corrupt vine growers trying to take over. Then you have the last two parables, which both involve interesting idea of slaves getting mistreated and abused and murdered, because that happens both in the vineyard and also at the wedding feast. And then finally, those last two parables also have something else in common, in that there is a mass execution. The vine growers are all going to be completely wiped out by the owner of the vineyard, and then the city that mistreats the slaves of the king gets wiped out as well. So you have mass executions in both of those two parables. Lots of common themes in those three parables. Moving away from the parables again, we see another common theme here, and that is the repeated weakness of the Jerusalem authorities, in that they fear the people on account of a prophet. And this occurs both toward the beginning and toward the end. It shows up first with John the Baptist, when Jesus is confronted by them about his authority, and he tries to turn the tables on them and brings up the ministry of John the Baptist. We see that they fear the people because they regard John as a prophet. Later on, after Jesus tells his second parable, they get really angry at him, but again, they fear the people, this time on account of Jesus and the regard that the crowds have for Jesus, at least at that time. So there's a common theme there with the weakness of the Jerusalem authorities, with the fear they have, basically fearing the crowd. All of that to say, there's a lot of detail here in this portion that unites it together as a single portion. That is one good reason to view it all as one united portion here in Matthew's Gospel. However, the true connection between these passages is that they display the leaders of the kingdom losing the kingdom. And this is what I have tried to show you as I've gone through these six passages, and what I will try to show you again as I do my summary today. Though we begin this portion with a mysterious object lesson with the fig tree, Jesus makes himself more plain as he goes along with what he is trying to convey in his actions and his words at this time. And it is very much a message sent to the leaders of Israel at that time that they have lost the kingdom of God. So before we move forward in Matthew with the rest of section 6, let's look backward and see once again how Jesus conveys to the Jerusalem authorities their loss of the kingdom of God. So let's start with the first passage in this portion with the fig tree. About the withering of the fig tree at the word of Jesus. And from this passage, we learned about the impatience of God. That, I believe, was the title of the sermon I did on this passage. This is Matthew 21, verses 18 through 19. It says, "Now in the morning, when Jesus was returning to the city, he became hungry. Seeing a lone fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it except leaves only. And he said to it, 'No longer shall there ever be any fruit from you.' And at once the fig tree withered." The main point of this passage about the withering of the fig tree is that sinners risk suffering under the impatience of God, just as Israel did after the days of Jesus. So that is the main idea. First of all, very much a message conveyed to the people of Israel at Jesus' time, but a warning for all sinners of all times about the impatience of God. When I taught about this passage, I began by saying that Jesus' impatience toward this fig tree is prophetically motivated. And that was to answer the question as to why this whole event even happens and what Jesus is thinking. He certainly does display some impatience at this point. You're here with this fig tree being hungry as he is and hoping to find some food and finding nothing. He lashes out in a sense and curses this fig tree and causes it to wither. And it's quite odd for Jesus to show that kind of impatience altogether, and even more strange to see him show that sort of impatience toward a tree, toward something that doesn't even have a will. It's not a person, as though it could be blamed for anything. So it is a strange event. However, the actions of Jesus here are very much like some actions that we see performed by the old prophets in the Old Testament when they're trying to teach something. And that is what I mean when I say the actions of Christ are prophetically motivated. He's trying to do something like what the prophets would often do in some of their strange actions that they would perform. So all we need to do is learn the lesson that is intended by this fig tree's withering, and then we will understand why Jesus reacts the way he does. As for what that lesson is, I said that Jesus' impatience toward the fig tree is a foretaste of the judgment coming upon unrighteous Israel. So it is meant to be an object lesson of the forthcoming judgment on the sinners that are there in the nation of Israel at that time. And I went about proving that to you in a few different ways. First of all, Israel was often compared to a fig tree in the Old Testament. I went through some passages where that sort of language is used to not really describe Israel, but just discuss Israel in the Old Testament. Also, this curious fact that the flourishing and withering of fig trees was often used as a kind of signal as to whether God was blessing or judging the nation. In the Old Testament, whether in the law or in the prophets, you see these times when, for some reason, that is what God points to as a sign of whether he's blessing the nation or cursing it. How are your fig trees doing? You know, are they yielding their fruit or not? And you should take warning accordingly as to what God is doing. So for those reasons, I suggested to you that Jesus' impatience toward the fig tree is a foretaste of judgment coming upon Israel for their sins. Now, more specifically, I said that the withering of the fruitless fig tree symbolizes God's impatience toward and rejection of the Jerusalem authorities. I wanted you to specifically narrow this object lesson of judgment down to those men, the people that were in charge of Israel at this time. I considered it necessary to narrow the scope of Jesus' judgment on the nation simply because some Jews became Christians. We know that just from reading the Gospels. We know that from the afterword of the ministry of Christ, when all the first followers of Christ were Jews. We know that not all of them are falling under this judgment. And based on the passages especially that follow this passage and the rest of this portion, we can see that the curse of Christ on this fig tree is really not a warning to the entire nation, just the sinners. And really, as he goes on talking, you see that Jesus really has in mind the Jerusalem authorities and their lead role that they have in leading the nation astray. So the true condemnation is against them. And this sign of the fig tree that he performs is against them. And finally, I ended my sermon on this event by saying that Israel should have taken warning at the threat of God losing his patience. That is, of course, the point of prophets giving the warnings that they give, to give a chance to repent. Israel did not repent. They really continued, for the most part, to follow their leaders, who in their own way continued in their wickedness, and all things continued unabated. And therefore, the nation faced the impatience of God toward them, especially seen in the Roman siege of Jerusalem 40 years later, when the judgment of God fell in a very noticeable way on that nation. And many of those leaders and many of those people would have been still alive at that time and would have faced the impatience of God when he finally brought judgment. So this withering of the fig tree and the impatience of God that it represents is our first look at how the leaders of the kingdom lose the kingdom in the days of Jesus. It is a very indirect way of going about it, but this ominous curse on this fig tree really does set the tone of the forthcoming portion. Long before Jesus started preaching the kingdom of God, Israel had some claim to being the kingdom of God. We often think about the kingdom of God as being part of the message of Christ, but really, among the Jews, they would have said that already about themselves, that the kingdom of God was primarily them. And the leaders of Israel, therefore, would have expected to be the leaders of God's kingdom. After all, who else would it be? Who else would it possibly be than the priests and the scribes and the elders of Israel at that time? And those leaders probably expected when the Messiah came that they would continue on as leaders of the nation. That when the Messiah came, it would not represent any demotion of them. It would just be adding another layer above them, and they would just continue as the Messiah's underlings. Probably that is what they had in mind, at least among those leaders who were expecting a Messiah, which would have been most of them probably. But things do not turn out the way that they planned. Jesus uses this fig tree as an object lesson to show that God was actually becoming impatient with them in particular, that the leaders of the nation were not walking in righteousness and not judging righteously, and were to be objects of God's impatience whenever the Messiah actually came. And very soon Jesus would speak more plainly about all of that to the leaders themselves as this portion continues. But it begins with this object lesson with the fig tree at the very beginning of this portion. For now, we're going to move on to the second passage in this portion of Matthew, which is the question of the disciples about the fig tree and how Jesus answers them. Because the disciples notice what Jesus just did, and they also want to know about it, and they ask him a question, which he then answers. And from this passage and from the answer Jesus gives, we learn about faith in God for the work of God. That was my summary and my title of the sermon I taught on this particular passage, which is Matthew 21, verses 20 through 22. It says, "Seeing this, the withering of the fig tree, the disciples were amazed and asked, 'How did the fig tree wither all at once?' And Jesus answered and said to them, 'Truly I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, be taken up and be cast into the sea, it will happen. And all things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive.'" So Jesus answers the disciples by speaking to them about faith in God for the work of God. And specifically, Jesus teaches that believers can be so free of doubt that nothing can stop us from performing the work of God. Now, I went about showing that to you very slowly over the course of the whole sermon, but nonetheless, that was the point: faith in God for the work of God. To start with the faith itself, there arises the question is how you have such faith. How do you have the kind of faith? What is the kind of faith that Jesus describes here, really? Well, to have such faith, the believer must have a united mind, which is the phrase that I use to describe the kind of faith Jesus is talking about here. In my sermon on these verses, I mentioned that the word for doubt used by Matthew refers to having a divided mind. It's the kind of mind in which you're saying to yourself, well, this might be true or this might be true, I just don't know. It's a divided mind. And when Jesus says, do not have doubt, he's talking about the opposite of that, which is a united mind in which you know what is true. You don't have any divisions within yourself about what is going on. So the believer must have a united mind, that is a mind which has no division in itself about God's plan. Now, that kind of leads into where I went next with all of this, and that was the idea of joining God in his work. So it's not your plans. It's not that you have single-mindedness about what you want. It's rather that you have a united mind about what God wants, God's plan. It's the work of God. And I get this primarily from the figure of speech used by Jesus here about moving the mountain. This is, of course, one that gets the attention of anyone that reads this passage. But I talked about it by going back to the Old Testament, and I showed you that the image of moving mountains was used in the Old Testament figuratively for the work of God. There are several passages where prophets in particular are describing the work of God that he has in mind as being moving mountains out of the way or leveling mountains and things like that. So that is the idea that lies behind this figure of speech. It's rooted in the Old Testament. This mountain-moving faith is not for anything we want, but for God's work, which again goes back to having the united mind, not about what we want, but about what God wants and about the work of God. So all of this comes together in this one idea, faith in God for the work of God, having a united mind about what God is going to do and then joining him in that work through faith. Now, based on this passage, we saw that the believer can join the work of God in two ways. And even though I say it, that it's two ways, I also argued for you that it's actually one way, and they are actually one and the same thing. But those two ways, to talk about them separately at first, the first one is by prayer. You can join in the work of God by prayer. As Jesus says, all things you ask for in prayer, believing you will receive. So prayer is one way that we can join in God's work. But the other way to join in the work of God is through our own commands. Because again, before he talks about prayer, Jesus says, he says that if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what was done to the fig tree, but even if you say to this mountain, be taken up and be cast into the sea, it will happen. So it's you commanding the mountain in the same way that Jesus commanded the fig tree. So it's your command here. It's not even praying to God. It's just you uttering what is going to happen. So your own commands are a way for you to join in the work of God. Now, as I went along with this, I showed you just from other passages in the Bible that very often this whole idea is actually one idea. The idea of praying to God for something to happen and commanding it to happen yourself, very often they overlap. They become one thing. And that is simply because if your mind is truly united to the point where you know what God's plan is and you know that you're joining in the work of God, whether you pray to God or just give the command yourself at that point doesn't even really matter anymore. You are now just speaking for God one way or the other. So that is the glorious and mysterious point of this whole thing about joining God in his work. Now, I ended by coming to the real crux of the message, and that was simply, how do you get this kind of faith? How do you get there? Well, I went to broader biblical teaching on that to see what the rest of Scripture has to say. And there are basically three different ways you can attain this kind of united mind where your faith has no doubt and you can join God in his work. Way number one is through a revelation from God in which he shows you what he wants to do. Number two is a spiritual gift. Paul talks about a spiritual gift which he calls faith, and mountain-moving faith and things like that. And then finally, the third way is simply confidence in the promises of God about prayer. And of course, the Bible makes many promises about prayer. And if you invest yourself in those things and claim them and order your prayer life according to them, you can have this kind of united mind as you pray. So all of that to say, this is about faith in God for the work of God, this idea of moving mountains by your command and by prayer. Now, of all the passages in this portion of Matthew, this one seems to have the slightest connection to the main theme of this portion as I understand it. The summary that I've given you for this portion is the leaders of the kingdom lose the kingdom, whereas this portion seems to be a very great promise being made to the disciples of the kingdom. So the connection seems pretty slight. However, I do think this passage fits into that theme in some way. In the time of Jesus, the faithful probably had no greater mountain to move than the hostility of Israel's leaders to their own God and their own Messiah. That was the big problem that any disciple of Christ would have seen right there from the very beginning. Before Jesus even died, before he rose from the dead, the disciples are realizing that Jesus and the leaders of the nation are not on the same page and something's got to give. And then, once Jesus is raised from the dead and ascends to heaven and he is gone, the disciples know they have to face this effectively on their own. So that's a pretty big mountain. I mean, they have to face a hostile nation led by hostile leaders from the very beginning. That is a real threat which seems great enough to kill God's kingdom in the very cradle. I mean, before the church reaches its first birthday, its first anniversary, this is a real threat to the survival of the kingdom of God. And doubtless the first Christians found that mountain to be a very great obstacle in their way. They're going to want to know how to move that mountain. And Jesus tells them here in the week before his murder that there is a reason to hope. There is a reason to hope in the face of this mountain that it can be moved. And he gives them this encouraging word that if they have faith and do not doubt, they will be able to move mountains like this out of their way. Even if it is a hostile nation led by hostile leaders, they will be able to move this mountain if they only trust in the Lord for the work that they know God is doing. You know, they're going to come through the ministry of Jesus with all of its miracles and all of its wonders. They're going to see the resurrection of Christ. They're going to see him go into heaven. I mean, by that time, they're going to know that God's working. All they have to do is stick with that plan and trust in the plan of God and remain of a united mind, and God will give them the power to move this mountain and any other mountain that stands in the way of the kingdom of God. So the disciples have not only inherited these pretty big mountains to move, but they've also inherited a chance to join God as he moves those mountains out of the way for his kingdom's sake. And of course, we also have that same promise as they had. So that is the lesson from this particular question of the disciples and how Jesus answers them. Now, once we get to the third passage in this portion, we come to the real purpose of this portion and everything really coming together to where you really start to see where this is going. You know, we move from the hazy object lesson to plain words when we get to the third passage. And that is the argument between Jesus and the Jerusalem authorities over his own authority and their authority. The key word being authority. You know, by whose authority do you do these things? And Jesus turning the question back on to them. And for this passage, we see that the world prefers its own immoral authorities to the moral authority of God's kingdom. We really see from this what the world prefers, that the world really does love its own, as Jesus says in another place. But for here, Matthew 21, verses 23 through 27, we see it in this way. It says, "When Jesus entered the temple, the chief priests and the elders of the people came to him while he was teaching and said, 'By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority?' Jesus said to them, 'I also will ask you one thing, which if you tell me, I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. The baptism of John was from what source? From heaven or from men?' And they began reasoning among themselves, saying, 'If we say from heaven, he will say to us, then why did you not believe him? But if we say from men, we fear the people, for they all regard John as a prophet.' And answering Jesus, they said, 'We do not know.' And he said to them, 'Neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things.'" As I said, this confrontation shows us that the world prefers its own immoral authority to the moral authority of God's kingdom. The world prefers not just sin, but sinful leaders over against righteousness and the righteous man who heads God's kingdom, Jesus Christ. Now, from the start, we see that the chief priests and the elders join the opposition against Jesus. These are the two groups of men that come to Jesus on this occasion, which is a bit of a shocker, because until now, Jesus has been opposed primarily by the scribes and their followers, who are the Pharisees. We normally see the scribes and the Pharisees following Jesus around, creating trouble. It's not really until Jesus enters Jerusalem, and not really until this passage, that we see the chief priests and the elders join the fight. And actually, from here on out through to the end of the gospel, it's primarily going to be these men. The scribes and the Pharisees kind of check out, and the chief priests and the elders take over as the leaders of the opposition to Jesus. So this is the other two-thirds of the Jerusalem government joining the fight against Jesus and really taking it over. Now, immediately after these leaders confront Jesus for the first time, Jesus effectively exposes the sins of the chief priests and the elders. So these men literally do not last 5 minutes in their opposition to Jesus. He already has them up against the ropes, so to speak, if you want to use a boxing analogy or a professional wrestling analogy, whichever you prefer. He has them right where he wants them. from the moment they start the fight. I mean, they're going to go in there, you know, kind of a tag team situation. The scribes and the Pharisees check out. These men come in, and Jesus just takes them on immediately, and they're down for the count. The sins that these men exhibit as they try to answer Jesus' question are faithlessness and cowardice, as shown by their reaction to John the Baptist. They show their faithlessness in that if John is from heaven and his baptism is from heaven, it is faithlessness not to believe him. But, you know, even if John's ministry was from men and of no value, they show their cowardice in that they fear the people and they're not willing to give that verdict. So either way, they're either faithless or they're cowards, one way or another. So Jesus very effectively exposes their sins by asking them this question. Now, in consequence of their sins, the leaders lose their authority to Jesus. They actually, in a sense, in this fight, Jesus takes something from them. He takes it from them, and they're never going to get it back. Specifically, they lose the right to judge Jesus and lose respect in the eyes of others. First of all, they lose the right to judge Jesus. That was the idea. When they come and ask him, by what authority do you do these things, they're presupposing they have the right to judge his answer. They have the right to judge whether he actually has sufficient authority to do these things. By showing these men to be faithless cowards and ignorant in their own way, they lose that right. I mean, if they can't judge John the Baptist, how are they going to judge Jesus? If they fail to judging one prophet, how are they going to judge another prophet? I mean, they lose that. Jesus just takes that from them. But also, they lose a bit of respect in the eyes of the people because they know they've just been shamed. And everyone standing there knows that Jesus just got the better of them. So in a culture where honor and shame matter a great deal, these men have been shamed. Jesus takes their honor from them in this altercation. And now, by comparison, Jesus looks all the more worthy of authority in contrast to these men. He appears to be a man of faith and courage and insight, whereas these men appear to be faithless cowards who lack insight, and he appears to have the greater honor after this altercation is over. So, yeah, they lose a lot. Here, within about 5 minutes of their first conversation with Jesus, Jesus takes a lot from these men, right here and now. However, this revelation of Jesus' rightful authority serves only to further condemn the nation and its leaders. It further condemns the leaders of the nation because, at this point, they do not confess those things. They do not confess their own unworthiness, and they do not confess the worthiness of Christ. They just continue on in their wickedness from here on out. And the rest of the nation, to its great shame, continues to follow their leaders. You know, for now, they still have some amount of respect for Christ, but by the end of it, the crowds are going to be right there with their leaders, moving for the crucifixion of Jesus whenever Pilate gives them a choice between Barabbas and Jesus there at the very end. So really, it just shows you that even though Jesus, before these leaders themselves and the whole nation, even showing himself to be the rightful moral authority, this nation still prefers sin. They still prefer the immoral authority of the world. Now, as often is the case in Matthew, he has several reasons for recording this. He has several reasons why he wanted his readers to think about these things. First, as always, is a chance for the people to repent. You know, Matthew's writing this, I think, primarily for Israel, just a generation or so after the time of Jesus, bringing this to their mind again. You know, they say hindsight is 20/20. You look back on these things, I think the hope is that people will read this and say, ah, what were we thinking? I mean, Jesus really knows how to handle these guys. He obviously is the better man. What were we thinking in siding with the leaders of the nation against him? Hopefully, that will lead to some repentance, and I think Matthew does hope for that. Secondly, for those of us who have repented and sided with Christ, this passage should remind us of how otherworldly our kingdom is and how little we belong to this world. Because again, the fact is still there. If Jesus himself, as gloriously righteous as he was, could not win the favor of most of the world, we're not going to have much better fortune. We're going to face the same kind of problem in every nation, in every generation, when the right moral authority of the kingdom of God comes up against the immoral authorities of the kingdoms of this world, the kingdoms of this world are going to have the immediate advantage. We know that in the end, God will vindicate us, but in the here and now, in this age, we're going to face persecution just like Christ did. And the nations of the world are going to be following their leaders in that way. Finally, and more to the point of the sermon today, we come again to this idea of the leaders of the kingdom losing the kingdom. And you might say the leaders survive this confrontation, right? I mean, they get out of there, and the nation is still going to be following their lead in opposing Jesus. But in reality, the leaders only survived because they moved themselves and their whole nation outside of the kingdom. Once they left behind such things as faith and courage and really the knowledge that they should have had regarding John the Baptist and Jesus, once they left those things, they left the kingdom of God. You know, they only survived because they moved themselves out from under Jesus and everything he was saying. You know, they survived by officially setting up a rival kingdom. You know, Israel at this point was no longer the people of God, so to speak. It's now being led by men who are overtly not repenting and who are overtly opposed to Jesus, even though he is most evidently the better man and a man of God. So really, you see, not only did they lose the kingdom, they moved themselves out of the kingdom. They gave it up by refusing to repent and refusing to confess the rightness of what Jesus was saying. So all of that falls under the summary statement that I've given you about the leaders of the kingdom losing the kingdom. That brings us to the fourth passage. And when we get to the fourth passage, we finally get to the three parables that Jesus tells to these Jerusalem authorities. The first of these parables is the parable of the two children. Or most Bibles will say, you know, the two sons, and it actually uses the word son. I prefer the translation child. I think it's more accurate. But the parable of the two children. And from this parable, we see the leaders of the kingdom will lose rank in the kingdom. That is how Jesus portrays it as he tells this parable, the idea of losing rank, losing preeminence. Let's read Matthew 21, verses 28 through 32. This follows right on the heels of his earlier confrontation with the chief priests and the elders. It says, "But what do you think? A man had two children, and he came to the first and said, 'Child, go work today in the vineyard.' And he answered, 'I will not.' But afterward he regretted it, and he went. The man came to the second and said the same thing, and he answered, 'I will, sir.' But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father?" They said, "The first." Jesus said to them, "Truly I say to you that the tax collectors and the prostitutes will get into the kingdom of God before you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes did believe him, and you, seeing this, did not even feel remorse afterward, so as to believe him." This parable describes people who may be called the first children of the kingdom. That is the title that I gave of this passage, and it's the description I give of these tax collectors and these prostitutes mentioned by Jesus, the first children of the kingdom. They are the first children partially because they repent and believe before anyone else. They were the ones right there when John the Baptist was still preaching. They were the ones that saw the need to repent, and they repented long before anyone else, especially the leaders there, saw the need. But also they are the first children because they achieved the first place of honor in the kingdom through repentance and faith. As Jesus says, they enter the kingdom before you, before the leaders of the nation. They get in there first. They are the ones leading the way into the kingdom, so to speak. So they now have the place of preeminence, whereas the leaders are losing rank by comparison. Now Jesus shows this again by describing two kinds of children and the real people they represent as being marked by different virtues. And that's how I told you to see this parable as we talk about the two children in the parable and the people represented by those children. On the one hand, the repentant tax collectors and prostitutes, and on the other hand, the elders and the chief priests of the nation. They're marked by different virtues. The first children have their repentance and their faith, and the repentant prostitutes and tax collectors are, of course, being represented there as these first children. So the first child says he will not go work in the vineyard, but then he changes his mind and he does. He has the virtue of repentance, just like the tax collectors and the prostitutes did. Meanwhile, the second children have a very different set of virtues. They have profession and prestige, because as the leaders of the nation, as the chief priests and the elders, they have a godly profession and they have the prestige of being leaders of the nation. And that is how Jesus represents them. They have those virtues. Now, according to the parable from Jesus, the wrong children are honored in the kingdom of God. And I say it that way because that's probably how it would have been viewed to anyone standing there listening to Christ at this time. We expect God to bestow the greatest honor on lifelong profession and prestige. Here are these men who have served God their whole lives as priests, or who have enough renown among the people of God to be regarded as elders of the nation. Surely that's worth something. Surely the lifelong profession and prestige of these men is worthy of honor from God. And to that Jesus says, no, it's not worthy of honor from God. Instead, these tax collectors and prostitutes are going to be honored. It's like, well, what did they do? They've spent their whole life in sin. And Jesus says, yeah, but they've repented and believed when the time came for belief and repentance, when John showed up and started preaching repentance. And God bestows honor on them instead. It shows you how God actually doles out the honor of the kingdom. He doesn't care about lifelong profession and prestige. He cares about repentance and faith. So finally, we can see how greatly God honors repentance and faith in these first children. And when you think about all the details here, first of all, God honors faith and repentance more than Israel's history and heritage. I mean, you think about the illustrious history there in Israel, all the centuries, the millennia really, that God had been working among the people of Israel, and all the history that's there. Even so, God only grants the kingdom to those who repented and believed. You would think, well, you know, I'm a Jew. You know, I'm a member of the people of God. I have all these ancestors who experienced the blessings of God. I have all these promises that God has made to my nation. Surely that counts for something. And Jesus says, no. God only bestows the kingdom on those who repent and believe. And if you haven't repented and if you haven't had faith, you don't get anything out of the kingdom of God. God does not honor you. Also, God honors faith and repentance more than our own understanding of godliness. You think about the understanding of godliness people had back then, they would have accorded it to men like the priests and the elders. They would have given their own honor to men who have that kind of lifelong profession and that kind of esteem. And we're no different. I mean, we get into that kind of habit of thinking that way. We think of the people as being kind of first in God's eyes, as being those that have some kind of preeminence, the great preachers or the missionaries or those that have done something great. It's not how it is. God honors repentance and faith in the same way that God honored the repentance and faith of those tax collectors and prostitutes more than he honored the priests and the elders. God does that today. God honors genuine repentance and faith more than any kind of prestige that we think of here in the church. That is how God operates his kingdom. And so this first parable gives us the first of three great reversals that Jesus describes for the kingdom of God. I encourage you to view every single one of these parables as describing a great reversal that takes place in the kingdom of God. And here is the first reversal. For the children of the kingdom, repentance and faith will outrank profession and prestige. You have everyone back then thinking that profession and prestige are what matter. Well, Jesus reverses those expectations. Turns out it's repentance and faith that matters. And those are the people that are going to have highest rank in the kingdom. Meanwhile, the leaders of the kingdom will lose rank in the kingdom because they don't have repentance, they don't have faith. They may have relied on their profession and their prestige, but that was a bad move on their part. They're going to lose rank in the kingdom of God. For the Jerusalem authorities, losing the kingdom is not merely losing the kingdom, but losing it to people whom they considered far outside of it and unworthy of it. They would have never thought these tax collectors and prostitutes being worthy of any kind of place in the kingdom. Even if they had credited them with genuine repentance and faith, they would have said, well, okay, that's good, but they showed up late to the party. I've been serving God all my life. I was born a priest, or I've spent my whole life gaining the prestige necessary to be viewed as an elder. I've been at this for a long time. Surely I'm going to outrank them. Well, instead, the tax collectors and the prostitutes far outrank them in the kingdom. And that is part of losing the kingdom from their perspective. They're losing it to these people whom they would have viewed as totally unworthy and outside of the kingdom, perhaps. And that is how badly they lose the kingdom. They lose it way bad to someone that they thought wasn't even in the race. That's how badly they lose the kingdom, according to this first parable. Which brings us to the second great reversal, as we see it in this second parable, which is often called the parable of the vine growers. And from this parable, we see that the leaders of God's kingdom lose God's patience. This brings us a bit back to that fig tree example, really, with the impatience of God being on display. Let's read Matthew 21, verses 33 through 46, the parable of the vine growers. It says, listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard and put a wall around it and dug a wine press in it and built a tower and rented it out to vine growers and went on a journey. When the harvest time approached, he sent his slaves to the vine growers to receive his produce. The vine growers took his slaves and beat one and killed another and stoned a third. Again, he sent another group of slaves larger than the first, and they did the same thing to them. But afterward, he sent his son to them, saying, they will respect my son. But when the vine growers saw the son, they said among themselves, this is the heir. Come, let us kill him and seize his inheritance. And they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those vine growers? They said to him, he will bring those wretches to a wretched end and will rent out the vineyard to other vine growers who will pay him the proceeds at the proper seasons. And Jesus said to them, did you never read in the scriptures, the stone which the builders rejected, this became the chief cornerstone. This came about from the Lord, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore I say to you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people producing the fruit of it. And he who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, but on whomever it falls, it will scatter him like dust. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they understood he was speaking about them. When they sought to seize him, they feared the people, because they considered him to be a prophet. Now, I had so much to say about this parable that I spent 5 sermons on it, going in great detail about the effort that Jesus seems to put into this parable, really constructing its details, and really wanting to convey a lot in a very short space, which I think he does effectively. But despite all the layers and details, the whole story contributes to this one idea that the leaders of God's kingdom lose God's patience. They've done it. I mean, God has had it up to here with them, and he's through being patient with the leaders of the nation. God himself is revealed as the owner of the vineyard. Of course, that doesn't take much imagination to see that the owner of the vineyard is God in this case. And the owner displays a remarkable patience toward his worthless vine growers. I mean, the first time that first group of slaves failed to get the produce from those vine growers, I mean, action should have been taken right then and there. Instead, he sends another group of people to try again, sends his own son to them, and only after that point does he lose patience with them. Although the owner possesses the irresistible power to bring those wretches to a wretched end, as soon as he desires, the owner does not immediately execute those vine growers. Apparently, he had the ability to get an army or some muscle to go in there and kill those guys, and that would have been no problem for him, but he waits. He gave them really three tries. It was only after three strikes that they were out. Meanwhile, the vine growers see this patience and abuse it. They just get worse and worse. I mean, they go to abusing this first group of slaves, to abusing a larger number of slaves, and then to murdering the son of the owner himself. I mean, the more patient the owner is, the worse these vine growers get. They treat the owner's absence as apathy, his servants as distractions, and even his own son as another opportunity to swindle the owner. They just don't get the picture that this guy is being patient with them for their good. They just keep getting worse. And even so, the Jerusalem authorities added their sins to the sins of their forefathers to abuse God's long patience. God had been tolerating Israel for a long time before this. The Old Testament is a huge record of that problem. And now these guys come along in the days of Jesus, and they just keep doing the same sins that their forefathers were doing, but they do it 10 times worse than that they do it to the Messiah himself. And God finally says, I've had it. I've lost patience. It's time to act against these ungrateful vine growers. So Jesus himself, as the son of the owner, about to be murdered by these ungrateful wretches in charge, announces the judgment about to fall on them, and even becomes, in his own way, the very reason for the judgment to fall, in that his murder brought the patience of God to an end. I mean, it all just culminates there with Jesus and their rejection of Christ and his murder of them. That was the last straw, and the patience of God was then over toward the leaders of that nation. Now, like the first parable, this second parable contains a great reversal for the kingdom of God. In yet another way, what you expect to happen is not what happens, but rather the opposite happens. The Jerusalem authorities, as said by Jesus, would have the kingdom of God taken away from them, while they would also be crushed by the cornerstone laid by God to build something new. Okay, so there's your first problem. The guys that have been in charge of the show for a while here, they're going to lose the whole thing. The kingdom of God gets taken away from them. And not only that, they get crushed. They don't just get demoted, they get destroyed. So you didn't see that coming. Now this cornerstone is the first step of building a new people of God, just as a cornerstone always is. It's the first stone that gets laid when building a building. And Jesus, in using this idea of the cornerstone, shows that God's going to build something new. He's going to build a new people who are actually going to give God what he deserves. They're going to give the fruit of the vineyard, so to speak. And the people that God's going to use are apparently people like these repentant tax collectors and prostitutes. God's going to start rebuilding his kingdom with them. So God's going to make a fresh beginning with these people who you thought didn't even deserve the kingdom, but God's going to restart the whole kingdom with them while the leaders of the kingdom lose what they had. So that is the next great reversal that we see in this parable. The leaders of the kingdom lose God's patience, while these other sinners who repented actually become a new beginning for God's kingdom. We finally come now to the last passage in this portion of Matthew, which is the third parable and the third great reversal that Jesus has in store for us with the kingdom. This is the parable of the wedding feast. And from this passage, we see that the leading city of the kingdom, the leading city loses the kingdom to the chosen few. So that is how I summarized this particular parable. This is Matthew 22, verses 1 through 14. Jesus spoke to them again in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son. And he sent out his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding feast, and they were unwilling to come. Again he sent out those other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, behold, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fatted livestock are all butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast.' But they paid no attention and went their own way, one to his own farm, another to his business. And the rest seized his slaves and mistreated them and killed them. But the king was enraged And he sent his armies and destroyed those murderers and set their city on fire. Then he said to his slaves, the wedding is ready, but those who were invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main highways, and as many as you find there, invite to the wedding feast. Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered together all they found, both evil and good, and the wedding hall was filled with dinner guests. But when the king came in to look over the dinner guests, he saw a man there who was not dressed in wedding clothes. And he said to him, friend, how did you come in here without wedding clothes? And the man was speechless. Then the king said to his servants, bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. In the prior two parables, all show the leaders of the kingdom losing the kingdom in some way or other, just like I've been saying for this whole portion. In this third parable, we see the same idea taught with yet another different focus. I think it's the same idea, but the emphasis is a bit different here. As I said, we see in this third parable that the leading city loses the kingdom to the chosen few. And by the leading city, I refer specifically to Jerusalem as the leading city of the kingdom of God. I put a lot of focus on the city described in this parable because I believe it represents Jerusalem in particular. Jesus describes in this parable all these people that are burned up in that first wave of judgment there as belonging to a single city, which is burned by the armies of the king. Now, there is only one city on the earth at the time of Jesus, which could have been called the city of God. You know, that would have been Jerusalem. You know, one city here that could have been the city of this king in this parable, who of course represents God. There's only one city that I think could have been in mind. And that city was excluded from the kingdom of God, right? They showed no interest in the invitation. They did not respond worthily, as Jesus says. And so their destruction is very much assured. And Jesus, I think, describes what would happen eventually later under the Romans, when armies actually did show up and actually did burn down a lot of the city, including the temple. That was the judgment that befell them. Meanwhile, the parable shows us something else about who will inherit the kingdom of God. So it's not just the leading city losing the kingdom, it's who actually gets it. It is the chosen few. As it happens, God patiently and generally calls many from Jerusalem and Israel, but only those few who honor God are actually chosen for the kingdom. Only those who accept the invitation and show up having prepared themselves correctly, only those few who honor God are chosen for the kingdom, in the same way that only those few are chosen for the wedding feast. I had to preach on this parable for three sermons before I finally explained all that was meant by honoring God, but it's like accepting the invitation to this wedding and also preparing for yourself for it by cleaning yourself up and putting on the right clothing. In that way, Jesus speaks of avoiding all of these problems. Now, most obviously, you cannot honor God by a shallow commitment or a lazy will or an act of contempt. Those are the problems seen in the first group of people, the first invitees, who were burned up when the city was set on fire. You can't honor God that way, but neither can we honor God by thinking that we can enter the kingdom merely by following a crowd. That's what this poor guy does who shows up without wedding clothing. He saw everyone else going to a wedding. He said, well, I'll go too. After all, everyone's invited, but he didn't prepare himself properly, and therefore he was thrown out. You can't just march along thoughtlessly following the crowd around you, you know, just because you grew up in church or grew up in a nation where everyone was a Christian anyway, so you thought, that doesn't cut it. You can't honor God like that. Truly honoring God is a matter of repenting, which I thought was the meaning behind this wedding clothing stuff. I think the figure of speech that Jesus uses there with the wedding clothing is primarily about repentance. That is how you honor God. While the idea is simple enough, it is actually difficult enough as well that few people actually do it. Few people actually make it to the wedding feast and get to enjoy that feast. few people make it to the kingdom and get to enjoy the kingdom because few people truly repent in a worthy manner. Truly, as Jesus says, many are called, but few are chosen. And in this way, the leading city of the kingdom lost the kingdom to the chosen few. And to this day, there are very few that inherit the kingdom. And that is the last great reversal regarding the kingdom of God that we see in this parable. Jerusalem had every reason to think that they were about to become the capital city of the kingdom of God. They lost that by not responding appropriately to the king whenever he arrived, and instead, the call of the kingdom went to the less respectable parts of the nation and selected its chosen few in the form of those few people, like the tax collectors and the prostitutes, who actually repented. That is the last great reversal of the kingdom of God in this last parable that Jesus tells these leaders of the nation. Considering these six passages in this portion of Matthew has brought to mind something Jesus said earlier, which I'll give to you as a way of closing this sermon and this summary today. This is from earlier in Matthew. Matthew 13, verse 12, where Jesus says this. He says, "For whoever has, to him more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But whoever does not have, even what he has shall be taken away from him." Well, the leaders of Israel at the time of Jesus truly had nothing. All right? They thought they had a lot, but they truly had nothing. And although I have spoken of them as losing the kingdom, we know they never truly had it to begin with. The kingdom of God was never really in their hearts in the way that it should have been. And as this portion of Matthew continues, we see Jesus strip the leaders of their delusion of possessing the kingdom. You know, they had nothing. All that they really had was the delusion that they had the kingdom. And Jesus takes that away from them in the way he talks to them. And even if that delusion was all they had, it was taken away from them all the same. Meanwhile, Jesus has promised an abundance to those who have, to those who actually possess something of spiritual value. Jesus promises them more and more until they have an abundance. And such people as the tax collectors and the prostitutes possess the kingdom of God in truth by virtue of their faith and repentance. They really had something by virtue of the fact that they believed and they repented. And as a result, they inherited first place and a fruitful vineyard, and a seat at the wedding feast of the king's son, which sounds to me like a pretty abundant blessing, all of those things, just as Jesus said. So these are the people that had something and were given more until they were given in abundance. Just as Jesus says, to him who has, more will be given until he has an abundance. But those who don't have, even what he thinks he has, is going to be taken away from him. Now, as we consider these things, we need to ask which group we will claim as our own, right? And of course, it's an obvious thing, but the trick with this is it never really is all that obvious. If it were, the leaders of the nation back then would never have had the hard time they had in accepting Christ as the Messiah. It sounds easy, but it's not that easy, is it? This idea of claiming the right side in all of this is actually quite difficult. We could claim, for example, the side of the chief priests and the scribes and the Pharisees without even knowing it, and the elders of the people without even knowing it. And I think we do, in fact, claim their side every time we stake our claim on the kingdom because of what we possess in ourselves. Anytime we comfort ourselves by saying, well, I have this, surely God has accepted me, especially if we find ourselves in positions of honor among other people, where other people are honoring us in that way, where they think, well, surely Stan is in the kingdom. He has this, this, and this. Anytime we find ourselves thinking in that way, we are at risk of being just like the leaders of Israel in the days of Jesus. It could be an office. It could be a godly heritage. It could be respect in the eyes of other people who think like we do. It could be any of those things. But all such claims today, whether among unbelievers or among professing Christians, are just as empty as they were for the men who murdered Christ. Those were men who thought they had things of real spiritual value. And those were the people who committed the worst sin in the history of the world. You got to be careful. You can very easily claim their side in this without even realizing it. The moment you begin to think like they do, you have actually chosen their side, and you have nothing, and what little you have will be taken from you eventually. It would be better to claim the other group as our own. You know, these are the people represented by the repentant tax collectors and the repentant prostitutes in the days of Jesus. That group is composed of foul sinners discounted by every decent person you know. You know, the people that you consider decent would have nothing to do with those kinds of people. And yet those are the people who are going to inherit the kingdom. Such people at least have no delusions about greatness. They cannot claim any great office as a sign of their favor with God. They have no prestige. They have nothing like that at all in their favor. They have nothing, therefore, except their repentance and their faith. And that's the mentality you want to have. You're coming before God with nothing except saying, I am repentant of my sins. I'm trusting in Christ for these things. You know, so help me God. You know, that's it. You know, that's all you're going to bring to the table. As often as you think like those people thought, you have something and you're going to get more and you're going to have an abundance. You're going to have those things that were promised to those people back in the days of Jesus. Which is just to say that God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble, as the Bible says elsewhere. So choose your side carefully. Be sure you're on the side of the humble and not the side of the proud. Because in the kingdom of God, things get reversed and you won't even know it until it's too late. So be sure you're shaping your mind correctly now around faith and repentance, just like the sinner that you are. All right. Well, that is what we have to learn from the leaders of the kingdom losing the kingdom. As I said, when I teach again next time, which will be later on in July, actually, probably, we're going to be taking a break from Matthew. I have a few messages planned just on various things that have come to mind, and we'll resume Matthew probably in a few months. Are there questions or comments on the things I was talking about today?